It wakes you up.
Great. So thanks everyone for being here today. We have really an exciting panel with some people that I very much look up to and see as champions and leaders in this transition to regenerative agriculture, agroforestry. And I'll start off with a little anecdote from this week, actually. I was one of the participants in the Sustainable Markets Initiative, which was organized by Prince Charles, and it's all about bringing leaders from 12 corporations, some of the largest food companies in the world, together to talk about this transition to regenerative agriculture. And you have leaders from Pepsi and Mars and other corporations championing that they're going to move to regenerative agriculture. And they're going to move into agroforestry systems and achieve net zero. But one thing they're not talking about is how they're going to support the farmers in selling the crops that aren't the commodity. So when I've gone on the ground with farmers in Brazil, in the United States, in India, and other countries, the corporations are looking to purchase just the commodities that they use in their system. And they're not really looking to pay a higher price for it, but they are looking to gain the benefit of calling themselves regenerative. And this isn't to slander the corporations. They're doing their job, and they're a key piece to achieving net zero sustainability. But what this panel's about and what we're here to talk about is solutions from the public sector, the private sector, the nonprofit world. How do we come together to solve for the investment and the commercialization of the secondary and tertiary crops that come out of a diversified agricultural system? So if you are moving from monoculture coffee into agroforestry coffee, and now you have bananas or plantains or black pepper or other crops that you now need to sell, how do you bring that to market? And how do we work together across public and private sector to create solutions so that farmers have a real incentive economically to move into agroforestry and regenerative agriculture systems? And so before we get in with introductions from all the panelists, maybe 2 to 3 minutes, and then we'll just have a very interesting dialogue, a Q&A amongst each other. I want to define my own definition, which I know there's about 2 million definitions out there right now and a lot of different names and titles for essentially the same thing. When I look at agroforestry, regenerative agriculture, I see it as a movement towards a focus on soil health, an understanding of biodiversity, and working towards this biomimicry of nature within the agriculture systems. And again, lots of definitions around it: climate smart ag, circular agriculture, organic, you name it. But we're really talking about moving from monoculture to polyculture, from focusing on extracting nutrients to replenishing and creating a flourishing soil and ecosystem. And so today we're really going to dive in beyond the superficial level into an engaging dialogue with Satya from Global Alliance for Sustainable Planet, Sol, who's here with the Ministry of Agriculture of Mexico, and Stephanie, who's here with Aon. So without further ado, I'll start with Satya. And if you want to give a few minute introduction to who you are and then how you're engaging with the agriculture sector and generative ag.
So I am Satya Tripathi. I head an organization called the Global Alliance for a Sustainable Planet. So I'm Satya Tripathi. I head an organization called the Global Alliance for a Sustainable Planet. We are based in New York, and our focus is to catalyze system scale shifts in both behavior and action. What you see at these COPs is something really gratifying as it is disheartening. The gratifying part is that the champions get to talk to each other, they get to meet, and they get to do something about it. What is disheartening is that we're the 27th version of the Conference of Parties. In the history of conferences and UN conventions, this one takes the top prize. We've been talking forever. Even very difficult conventions like the Civil Rights Convention or the Political and Economic Convention or the Human Rights ones didn't take 27 conferences to get to agreement. So this one has been a really self-defeating one. And when I say that, I'm not an outsider talking. Till last year, I was the Assistant Secretary General of the UN looking after environment. So I know, and I'm an insider who has been very frustrated at the lack of progress. But at the same time, the UN is a great convening place. It brings people together. It brings countries and ideas together. So that is its greatest strength, which is also its greatest weakness, because it has no authority to really get anything done. So it can bring people together, but then it is us who will have to make something possible. So I think in that context, this conversation is extremely important. How we are engaged with agriculture, I think if we had our way in the next 10 years, we would have at least 200 million people, 200 million farmers switching to regenerative agriculture. And I say this with humility and a lot of confidence. Humility because it's a gigantic venture. Confidence because a program that we've been supporting for 5 years has now reached more than 1 million farmers. And we did that not by putting money or anything. We don't give money as an organization. We make things possible. We make money happen, but we don't give. We're not a donor. And how do we do that? This particular project in India that has now exceeded 1 million farmers, smallholders, last year got funded by the German Development Bank, 300 million euros at 0.5% interest. So that's what is possible when you get to a certain level of scale. Then the evidence is mounting in such a way that people really can't turn their eyes away. It's like, you know, you see something, whether it's Mother Nature or a person or a movie or a show, you just can't turn away, you know, you stop and see, or a work of art, whatever, you know. So this is something like that. It has gotten to a stage that every time I go there and meet the women farmers who are making this possible, you just are so grateful to them for what they are doing to bring back Mother Nature in its pristine glory. And through agriculture, not by dropping yields. The yields are up anywhere between 30 to 200%, depending on the crop and the agroclimatic zone and the purity of the intervention, because there are protocols to follow. If you don't follow it well enough, then the yield doesn't work. Water conservation, electricity savings, and most importantly, input costs drop by as much as 80%. So poor people actually don't have to go and borrow money and literally wager their life not being able to pay it back. So I'm sure we'll discuss more about it, but that's our goal, to get to 200 million smallholders in the next 10 years, and not just by talking, by getting them money to do what is right. Thank you.
Thank you, Sadi. Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Sol Ortiz. I work at the Ministry of Agriculture and Rural Development in Mexico. I'm in charge of the General Direction of Climate Change Policies and Prospection. That's the translation I put it in this charge I have. And what we are doing there is we are the part of mainstreaming biodiversity and climate change within agriculture. And this is not an easy work from the Ministry of Agriculture because traditionally there has been this disconnection. But now we are very lucky that our minister has this view of having the view of agriculture in a very systemic way. So what are the main plus that we have in Mexico to mainstream biodiversity within agriculture to start with? Mexico is the center of origin of many crops, and we also are a mega diverse country. And this is related to having a mega diversity country with a lot of native crops, with the way farmers, small farmers, particularly indigenous people, do their farming. So we are in a very good place to start with to keep promoting agroforestry systems. And why? Because from starts, we have what is called the milpa. The milpa is a very diverse cropping system, which has what is known as the three sisters, corn, beans, and squash, or calabaza, we call it. Okay, thank you. But not just those, also sometimes chili and many other herbs that are edible and that farmers use for a diverse diet. This is a system which is not highly productive in terms of tons per hectare, but it is very important for self-sufficiency because it promotes a very nutritious and diverse diet. And what we have been doing now in the government recently, besides trying to help these farmers to maintain their diversity crops, because most of these systems are used with small farmers in places that is not easy to crop. And this is places where the land is not straight. So what is it that they are doing now? We are promoting what is called MIAF systems, which is milpa intercrop with fruit trees. And not just fruit trees in some places, also the SAF system, which is systems for agroforestry, where you have the crops and also the trees. This is a program that the government has been implemented that is called Sembrando Vida, or sowing life or planting life, according to the best translation. And this program has been reaching almost 500,000 farmers in 21 different states of Mexico. And they are accompanied by some rural schools for extension for these farmers to help them to maintain not just their milpa systems, but enrich them with also forest trees. So this is one of the focus that we have in this program, Sembrando Vida, or Planting Life. The other issue that we have been involved in within the Ministry of Agriculture is trying to integrate all these systems in a view that will create synergies. So we have our national strategy for sustainable soils, which is in Spanish called the ENASAS. And we also have program of work for genetic resources for food and agriculture, which is also related with climate change, both of them, because as you know, soils are very important, a way to capture carbon. If we have fertile soils with organic matter, you can have more fertility, but also reduce emissions. And we also have another main strategy, which is the national conservation of pollinators. So this is a way to integrate in not just soils and water management, but also biodiversity, not just biodiversity within the soils, but biodiversity that contributes to production, and these are pollinators. So this is in general what we are trying to do in the Ministry of Agriculture in collaboration with other partners, and this is to put farmers in the center of our work. So I hope to keep sharing with you more experiences. Thank you.
Thank you, Saul. And briefly, I'm Keith Agoda, CEO of Producers Trust, and we are a global digital platform connecting agricultural producers to markets through digitization, helping share authentic stories. We're now working on data capture at the source so we can validate sustainability claims. And this is all about bridging between markets and producers and multi-stakeholders so that we can build greater profitability to farmers. And just a quick story of how I got into agroforestry and regenerative ag. I was in actually Michoacán, Mexico with Lionel Chavez, who was an avocado farmer I was working with. And he goes, I want to teach you about farming. So he took me to the forest and we walked through the forest. And he brought me to a blackberry patch where there's berries growing in the wild. He goes, this is agriculture. And then he took me to his avocado farm and he ignored all these avocado trees and all these avocados growing on the trees. And he started showing me how the color of the grass looks more fluorescent when you have healthy soil. And he started digging in certain areas of the farm and showing me how many insects and worms were in his soil. And so what I learned at that moment, and that was probably close to 8 or 9 years ago, was that agriculture is much less about the fruit or even the tree and more about how we are integrating and applying ourselves to nature. And what's been pressing me in starting this company 6 years ago and working on it is how do we solve for these major gaps so that we can move towards these more nature-inspired systems? And the three gaps that I'll be driving into once we hear from Stephanie are around post-harvest infrastructure. So how do we get from the harvest to market in a way that the farmer benefits and has a profitable harvest? The second is financing. How do we get farmers access to the capacity, to the loans, to the support they need to transition into these systems? And the third part, which is leaving my mind right now, I'll get into once I remember. So those are the areas we want to dive into. And without further ado, I'm going to pass it to Stephanie.
Thanks. Is it on? Hi.
No.
Yes. Hi. Brilliant. Hello, everybody. And thank you again for coming today. Thank you, Keith, for your kind invitation. I'm obviously very honored and humbled by for sharing a panel with all of you and all your amazing achievements. And so, wow. So what I take away, just to sum up what I've heard already today and how we can help play a small role. So first of all, I'll tell you a little bit about what we do. I'm Stephanie Betts, so I'm running straight into the topic. I'm Stephanie Betts, and I'm head of alliances, coalitions, and reporting on climate for Aon globally. And Aon is known as one of the largest global insurance brokers, but also probably lesser known for all its work on advisory. And one of the big focuses for us is on de-risking the transition, and it's helping good initiatives, such as what we're hearing about today, to be able to accelerate. So that we try to transfer some of the risk, we try to improve funding and facilitate funding in order to accelerate that transition. So we've heard today about the decade or the moment of doing. We have to get things done. We have to reach that last mile. We have to reach those farmers. And I was sat yesterday with an official who I will not name, but literally we sat over lunch and he said, we're here in our nice suits. My farmers are dying. They've been hit by another typhoon. While I'm here every day, farmers are dying. The week before I came, farmers were dying, and he was crying. And I said, I feel your pain. I'm half Haitian. I know what devastation looks like and when the systems break. So the second thing we talked about was obviously the systemic approach. And I was really happy to hear that word, because without it, we're not going to get anywhere. We really need to understand that everything has a role and everything has a place, and the interconnection between all of our actions and everything we do. So the word systemic is something that I would encourage all of you to really focus on. If I do something, what's the impact? If you want to get to a certain result, how would you get there? What is the best way to get a multitude of results? So talking about agriculture is obviously one of the key points, where a key area where you really, really see that from. It starts with the soil. The soil gives you healthy crops. A primary crop will give you a secondary crop. The secondary crop will give you a new income stream. We were talking about elephants the other day in Africa and saying, you know, instead of killing elephants that destroy your crops, why don't you plant chili all around it? They don't like chili, funnily enough. You know, suddenly you've got a secondary crop. So it's just really that mindset and that mind shift that is really, really important. And obviously, Keith, the final point which we're going to touch upon is education, soil and education. Education of all of us has to be at the heart of this transition. We have to be educated as to how people live and cultivate their land in other countries. We can't just go and apply our model. This boat has sailed. We didn't know any better. And I think the point now is all of us need to reinvent a model. And the West doesn't have a solution. Lots of problems in the West, lots of problems in developed countries. So we're not here to tell developing countries how to do it. We're here to think, how do we create a brand new systemic model that works for everyone, that feeds the planet, and that helps, you know, it helps it regenerate itself. And why did we damage it in the first place? Well, simply because I think, frankly, we just didn't know. We didn't know that natural capital that is so vital for our survival was not free. We didn't think we thought rivers come from mountains. They'll always be clean. So obviously, when you have companies putting all their effluents in the river and polluting everything downstream and killing fish and also livelihoods on their way, nobody really priced that. And the word pricing now becoming quite important. And it's going to go together with the world. Not damage, and that's another topic, but it's going to go together with climate litigation. So there are lots of forces at work right now to make things happen. And this is where probably Aon is trying to help by de-risking. If you look at insurance, we can de-risk investment, we can accelerate investment, we can accelerate transition by helping financing. Why? Because having a layer of insurance brings the risk down. You can help, it's not just reputational, but it's just ensuring, because we can't provide insurance unless we've actually checked all the data. So what we have is a lot of data. We spend 200 million a year on data, on system, and on people. We've got a number of, you know, risk engineers and climate data modelists. That is really ordained. They are data, and models. And this is the basis on which we can actually assess the risk and help assess the risk in various regions of the world, because the risk will be very different in every location. So it's very important that we're able to go very granular on that risk to create bespoke solutions. And I'll finish finally by saying, we're in the business of better decision, but the better decision today is to fight climate change, is to stop climate change. And there's just no two ways about it. And the bigger picture is, everybody talks about net zero. Well, net zero, nobody can get to net zero alone. And net zero will need natural capital, because this is where the carbon is kept. And this is also how we're going to feed the planet for the next, you know, generation. So it is very important to us that natural capital becomes the center of all conversations. So there's nature positive, but we'd like to think about nature centric. And I think this is the approach that we all need to take, in particular in finance.
Check, check. All right. Amazing introductions. Thank you so much. And I remembered the third one, which is, of course, markets. So post-harvest infrastructure, financing, markets. But before we dive deeper into the solutions, especially which we can find just amongst these four panelists, I'd love to ask Sol, If you could share a little bit more about your experience and with your constituents, the 500,000 farmers in Siembra Vida, the groups doing chinampas and the milpa systems, what are their greatest challenges that you're finding to being successful entrepreneurs as farmers and to be able to grow and thrive and scale what they're doing? So what are the key challenges that you're seeing on the ground?
Thank you for your question, Keith. The main challenge that we see is, first, how do can they produce enough for reaching the market? And second, how to have markets that recognize what they are doing and pay a fair price. So one thing that we are doing for that is we are generating a brand. I'm not sure if this is the right translation. It's what we call BioSello. And this BioSeal, it's a recognition for farmers that produce their products with practices that are friendly with biodiversity. So it's called Amigable con la Biodiversidad, friendly with biodiversity. And the way we're creating this brand is actually with the farmers. So it's not easy, but what we do is check with different types of crops, because this is not a general way of doing it. So we have started with coffee, with honey, with AgroSilver pastoral systems, and coffee, honey, and cacao, which is another important agroforestry system in Mexico. So what we do is check what are the different practices that can be called friendly with biodiversity. And this is a very participative process, not just the farmers, but also scientists that tells this practice will be good, but also the next question is, can you do it? How easy it is for you? Can this practice be part of you? But not just that. Many farmers say, this is the practice that I find more useful to keep my soil, to keep my biodiversity. And we integrate these practices in these formats that they can comply with. And the idea, we also already registered this BioSello, which is called Amigable with the Biodiversity in the INPI institution. And what we know is lacking, and that has to go all along the value chain, is the demand by consumers. Not just having the farmers doing the right thing, but getting the market for incentive by the farmers that are doing the right thing by getting those products. So this is the whole mechanism that we are constructing. And I have to say, it's not easy. We started with these crops that I told you, we have the practices for those. Now there's this demand for agaves, you know, the ones that you use for tequila and pulque and other beverages, which are very important. So these practices are related, mezcal, that's right, yeah. Are related also, for example, with pollinators. This practice, in the case of mezcal, how many plants do you have to leave without cutting the fluorescence to make sure that the pollinator is going to be there and that you will keep biodiversity by letting the intercrossing of these plants, you know, because producing mezcal and other beverages, you don't let the plants produce flowers and fruits. You are always doing this monocropping of clones. So these are the kind of practices that farmers recognize as important and that they are willing to do, but we have to generate the markets. We have to make sure that somebody who sees there's this product and says friendly with biodiversity and I want it and I'm ready to pay a bit more because I know that these farmers are contributing to maintaining pollinators, are contributing to using in very efficient way different incomes, inputs for the farmers, for the farm, and that these farmers are conserving their soils. So this is the link. I think it's not easy. And I like that you like the systemic approach because this is the way of going. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, please.
Thank you very much. And I think this is where things are becoming quite exciting because the next step for this, we have an element of education, mm-hmm. educating the farmers so they know because it won't be instinctive, right? They need to know what works. First of all, then you have data. So you collect the data, you can say, well, you'll make more money. You'll have better yields if you follow these practices. Education, mobile app, for instance, collecting the data and giving the, and transmitting knowledge. So that's one thing. The second thing that, in my view, is going to change things is transparency and labeling. For a consumer, you're in the supermarket, you have no idea. This brand versus that brand, same price, low price, you don't know. Or another one is a little bit more expensive and you think, why should I pay more? Unless you have a QR code and a label that tells you this is the value chain of that product, you can't make that decision. And this is where your market comes into play. So for your farmers to be incentivized, they have to see the financial benefit beyond the human benefit of, you know, healthy crops and et cetera. But they have, there has to be a link. And I think transparency and education is going to be that link. So part of our role is to work together with yourselves and people involved in that value chain and work with the regulators and legislators so that we no longer delay the transparency that is necessary. You can imagine it's a challenge for lots of reasons, but I think this is the way forward. So hopefully we can help by pulling together.
Yeah, thank you, Stephanie. And so, what I'm to summarize, there's farmers transitioning, doing the right practices, and they've created their brand. But now that brand needs to get to market and there needs to be a demand. And we've been working on this with one of the largest consulting companies in the world. And while maybe 70 to 80% of consumers say that they want this, they want the sustainable, transparent, better quality, but they're still making decisions based around price. So how do we bridge that gap? And I'd love to pass it to Satya here, because when we look at the community natural farming movement, Andhra Pradesh, that you mentioned, they're looking at solutions for how to bring these branded products within this model of regenerative agroforestry systems to market at the right price by eliminating waste and by making sure that all of the products are getting to market through a cold chain. So Satya, maybe you could share a little bit about that solution for how to get those products from the farms to market in a way that could be price competitive.
Thank you. Well, I also want to touch upon a bit about education. You know, the what is happening in Andhra Pradesh is not a technology intervention. It's a knowledge intervention, because these systems are highly knowledge intensive. What does a bag of fertilizer do? What exactly is it? It is actually knowledge in a condensed form. You put everything, the essence of science, you've done thousands of tests or even tens of thousands of them. You know this works to improve nutrient density, productivity. You get a bag, you don't have to think. You cut it up, you put it in your soil, and it gives you some productivity, and that's been going on for decades now. When you want to switch, you're not switching land, you're switching the farmer. That's where the difference is. This is not, you know, we often talk about, oh, you know, you need to change your land from chemical agriculture to regenerative agriculture. That's not what it is. The switching happens in the mind of the farmer. That's when, so we spend this particular program I'm talking about, it started with about $370 per farmer. Now that it has gotten to $1 million, a lot of the practices are now ingrained in popular culture already. So you don't need to do that anymore. That knowledge is permeable. It's like a neural bridge from a farmer to farmer extension. It's no longer a physical bridge where a teacher comes and says, you need to understand these things. That's happening already at a community level. Then there are those that you still need to do in terms of finding the right ingredients, knowing how to do them, making it available. So it's the costs are now down to $200 per farmer. And so unfortunately for us, for too long, we've been run by accountants. And I have a master's in finance, so I know what I'm talking. We know the cost of everything and value of nothing. That's what accountancy is all about. You know the cost of everything, the value of nothing. This is not a facetious statement. It's a fact. All of us have experienced accountants in our own offices, right? So here, since we have focused for too long on cost, we've lost track of value. What value nature brings, what value birds and bees on the agricultural landscapes do for the agricultural landscape itself. What is the web of life? How are we not just an integral part, but an inseparable part of the web of life? We somehow climb to the top of the species pyramid, and now we think everything exists for us. How stupid. Nothing exists for us. We think like that. That's a different thing. How you think does not change reality. It changes reality for you in your head, but reality for nature is exactly the same as it was before. You're still a part of, a very humble part of the web of life. It decides when to switch it on and switch it off. Not us. Mother Nature does that. It's done that to mighty species like the dinosaurs. We're nothing compared to them. Now back to the market story. The farmers need to be rewarded for the knowledge-intensive work they are doing. And you can do that in two ways. One, in the ways that Stephanie talked about, that Keith talked about, is about finding value in getting their products to market, understanding that, and it needs a serious dose of humility to ourselves, that there's a lot of effort that has gone into producing clean food. Yes, in 10 to 15 years' time, if the system scale switch happens, then that will become common knowledge. You don't need to do that anymore. It'll happen on its own, like it used to happen before the 20s and the 30s when NPK started becoming mainstream. So that's all right. That's in the future. But now, what we can do to accelerate the switch is three things. First is, of course, the access to markets. The second is finding the right value for their carbon. So we're working on building an alliance that will get farmers practicing natural farming or regenerative agriculture $100 per ton. The market is now 20. But we're creating that product segment and product differentiation, and we are building an alliance, a very powerful alliance of people who truly believe that this is possible. So when that happens, we also want to make sure that the farmers don't get 20% or 30% of the carbon price. You've seen the case in Mexico with the partnership with BP. The farmers were getting $4 out of 20. Horrible. And of course, I was moderating a panel on carbon markets at the Climate Action Zone. One of my panelists, I was asking about price and equity. He says, well, you know what? If you go to the furniture market, furniture is actually costing 20% for the carpenter, but we sell it at 100%. And his justification is, well, the farmer had zero before I came in, so it's all right for me to take 80%. Of course, I mean, that's his point of view that nobody in this room buys into. But our model is that the farmer must get 90% of the price, and the price must be $100 at least. So we're already talking to some of the biggest food companies in terms of, because they are very, I mean, they, not all of them really know their scope 3 emissions. They're all now keen to, because soon it will become a necessity. So they're working ahead of the curve and trying to understand what their scope 3 emissions are. And so they would be very happy to actually pay. These are happening in small doses of payments. It has been sold at 50, at 60, at 40. We can push it to 100. And so we'll do forward contracts, not just for now. We're telling them, don't wait till it becomes 200 in 10 years. We'll give you at 100 now and in 10 years as well. Because then the farmer can switch. So you are not just a buyer, but a champion who's engineering that shift. And be the champion you can be. So that's the carbon thing. In terms of the market access, we're building a super app where farmers are able to store, whether it's dry goods or wet, it's a cold storage or a warehouse with dehumidifiers and everything at a village level. So in the state of Andhra Pradesh, where this natural farming revolution is happening, the idea is to set up 13,000 farmer welfare centers. each with a cold storage and a dry warehouse with all, you know, debugging, dehumidifiers and everything in place, so that the farmer A has a safe storage space and B sells when the market prices are right. And we know that at harvest, the prices are roughly 30 to 40% of what it gets to in 2 to 3 months. So if you can keep that for those 2-3 months, create a credit line where the farmer actually gets the price. If they want to sell at harvest, we still let them sell. So they get that price. We're still holding their produce in trust. So when they, 3 months later, when the price is 3 times, we'll sell it at that. And minus the costs of cold storage and the credit line, you give the rest to the farmer. You can actually double the farmer income within 6 months, guaranteed. This is not voodoo economics. Anybody that has been to vegetable markets knows this. In season, you get the same thing for 10 cents. 3 months later, you get it for 30 cents. It's not rocket science. It's just playing with the market forces in a way that you bring out the best in the market system. So these are the two things that are actually going to transform the whole process.
Amazing. Thank you, Satya. And so I want to pass it to Stephanie, given your understanding of risk and insurance. So let's say you're able to aggregate thousands or hundreds of thousands or even in the millions of farmers and the value of their goods going to market and the value of their carbon going to market. Now, how do you see that value being leveraged or being utilized so that you can bring in that de-risking or insurance or private sector partners in order to drive that solution to really scale and accelerate?
Thanks, Keith. Is that working? I'm always funny.
It is working.
I have to do anything? No. Oh, no, that's it. I've got it. So I think this is a really interesting point. As we've discussed before, it's very difficult for an organization like ours to get down to the last mile and to the last farmer. That's impossible. Whether it's micro insurance or whether it's, you know, carbon credit, that's really difficult. And that's why that all the power is in the collective. Is it the regrouping? Is it the... And then once you have a bit of scale, then it gets a lot easier for us to actually look at it in its entirety. Obviously, there's a verification process and there's a framework that needs to be in place in order to enable us to have the right data. But that is just a necessary step for us. One of the things we've been looking at is looking at the V20 in particular, is thinking, how can we work with our client to have those extended supply chains all around the world and who depend on some of your crops for their products? How could we structure something that incentivizes them to look after their supplier tier 3, tier 4, tier 5, 6 maybe, all the way down the chain to strengthen their supply chain? And I think that's the revolution we're going through right now. It's a supply chain revolution. People use, you know, supply chain used to be a dark corner of everybody's mind and business. Nobody really knew or wanted to know what was going on. But what we've realized, in a way, what's happened recently has been obviously a curse and a blessing, is people realize you're only as strong as your supply chain. And there lies your power. Because now the light has been shone on that. And I think if you talk to supply chain experts, they're very excited because suddenly their time has come. And they realize that the supply chain and scope 3 is the beating heart of any company. And you have to protect that value chain. And I think this is what we have to crack literally in the next 12 months, 18 months. We don't have a lot of time. And that's linked also to scope 3. So coming back to carbon, when, you know, who cares? I mean, scope 1, scope 2, big deal. The key is scope 3. And scope 3 is doable. A lot of companies are not disclosing on scope 3. Technology is catching up with scope 3 as well. And all of that is part of that scope 3 decarbonization. And through that, again, it's another lever for you and for those farmers, is that we will need to get transparency all the way down the chain in order to get to scope 3 disclosure. So that's really helpful. So again, our role is to work together with legislators, with companies, to accelerate that change, to facilitate the change, to invest in the technology that's helping companies to get that level of transparency. So transparency is our friend.
Thanks. And I have a follow-up question. And just for everyone to be on the same page, scope 3, to put in context, if you're Nespresso and you have Nespresso coffee, the farmers of that coffee and their practices and how they're impacting their environments in order to create that coffee. That is scope three. And that is the responsibility of Nestle and Nespresso, who ultimately is selling the pods of coffee and making money from that sale. And so now they're being required to understand what are those impacts at the source and how to actually validate those impacts and report on those publicly. And so my follow-up question, when you hear these stories like Satya talking about a million plus farmers and that level of carbon credits, maybe 5 tons per hectare times $100 per ton, and you hear about the work with the 500,000 farmers in Mexico, this seems like a massive scale corporate finance insurance opportunity that right now is not even being touched. Do you see this as an area of growth for the industry?
Oh, absolutely. And I think insurers have to think bigger. They have to think wider. They have to think systemically. And I think so there's 2 points to this. And I wanted to come back a little bit on the coffee analogy. If we start to think systemically, we'll realize that all the coffee ground, the ground coffee, you've percolated your coffee. The coffee is very expensive to grow. You have to water it. Water is becoming so precious. We can't afford to waste it. So what are we going to do with the byproducts? We need to think of solutions. Can we use it to grow mushrooms that are high protein density to feed the world? You know, we need to start thinking, you know, because this is also de-risking. It's not, you know, waste when it's abandoned creates more carbon. Waste when it's recycled gives life, you know. So we need to think bigger in order to look at all of that opportunity. So I think we need to expand our horizons. We need to expand our understanding of the cycle of life. So we need to look at the full cycle. When you look at regenerative agriculture, it's from the beginning. It's shifting that farmer, it's looking at the seed, looking at the process, looking at the harvest, looking at the product, and then where the product is going and how. I'm sure you've all heard about this clipper who crossed the seas to bring coffee that was carbon neutral. It was like, I don't know, 20 pounds a pack of coffee. I thought, well, normally you pay £5 already. So I think considering their effort, I thought it was reasonable. Drink less coffee, drink better coffee, right? Drink clean coffee. So we need a mindset shift to do all of that. And I think for insurance, it's thinking about that circularity. And one more point on insurance and circularity and systemic thinking. Our fate is so closely tied to that of biodiversity, so closely. Because if we keep seeing the negative feedback loops that are at work at the moment, all we're going to, and if we don't try to support nature and the biodiversity system and all the ecosystem services, we're going to get to a point where insurers can't insure the world. That's not a fun scenario. And for me, this is when the penny dropped. One day I was sat. I remember where I was. I was by an elevator in one of my offices. And I remember thinking, I read this line. One of the insurers says, at +4 degrees, the world is no longer insurable. I just dropped my tools then. I dropped everything. And I thought, okay, I will do nothing else but that now for the rest of my life. So this is the fight, and this is what we have to achieve. But we need to think big. We need to think generous. We need to think circular. We need to think smart. We need to relearn to think. You know, as you say, we know the value of nothing. We've been obsessed with just the bottom line. This is a much bigger bottom line that we need to think about. You know, it's this whole, it's, and I think nature has a lot to teach us. So we need to get up to speed on that. That's a brand new system that we need to relearn.
Amazing. Thank you, Stephanie. And I'm going to pass it back to Sol here. And again, as you look to the milpa farmers or the farmers doing agroforestry in Mexico, what are the resources or support or what do you feel is required for us to work together to scale these efforts and to show that this is more profitable than doing monoculture? So what do you see as being the key missing resources that if you had, you know, a genie and you can make your wish, what would be the resources that could help you and your farmers scale these practices?
Yeah, well, I will go back to education. I think that's the key, because it's not just to sort of convince them, but they have to know, they have to have the knowledge of why am I doing this? And many of them does have that, but we have to improve that. And then after having the knowledge and education, we have to have the incentives in terms, not just for helping them do the transition, which is what we are doing right now. But to make that transition, it's profitable afterwards when you don't have the resources to facilitate the transition to the farmers. I don't know if I'm making sense, but that's part of what we are trying to do. Not to generate a generation of farmers that for doing the right thing will be expecting just some incentive in terms of money, but also having passed that transition to make sure that what they are doing is right and that they know that they are doing it because it's the way to contribute to this future on Earth, and that also that improves their production, improves their income, and make sure that this demand of consumer is there. So this is what the way I see it, not just as you get the money, I do this, because we have seen it before. You don't have the money to help them, they stop doing it. That's not what we want. So we want to generate the whole circular process where they start with a hard way of doing it, but with the help, and then the whole system works fine and they are convinced to do it and they see the benefits, and then they see the benefits not just in terms of the plan of the plot, which is very important, but the benefits in terms of what am I contributing to the planet, and the benefits of I am getting recognition of because of what I'm doing, which is sometimes what is missing.
Amazing.
Unfortunately, but I think one of the things we don't talk about this week is the impact of all of this on not just livelihoods, but community, connection, connectivity. People need to feel connected, empowered. And I think the impact of these practices on community well-being, and on people helping each other. So there's a bigger purpose. And I think that's really, really important. And once people connect to that, and you can create that circularity and that sort of more systemic thinking, even at a small level, I think this will make a big difference, because suddenly all of the farmers will support each other in doing the right thing, you know, and they'll check with each other. And, you know, I think it creates a different sort of positive feedback loop, hopefully.
Yeah.
Just add quickly,
please.
You know, one thing that has happened in this initiative.
I just want to give a round of applause for Stephanie. She has another panel. No, thank you. And how important it is to have large corporations represented here and part of the conversation. So really, it's an honor to have Stephanie here. But yes, Satya, back to you.
So I just wanted to add to what Stephanie said. In this particular project I was talking about, we picked up primary health center data from an area of 93 villages. They call themselves bio-villages now. So by a local village regulation, they don't allow any synthetic chemical fertilizers or pesticides to enter their village areas. So you can't bring it in anymore. Local village regulations. So, and that's been going on for a while. They call themselves bio-villages. So we thought, let's look at some proxy indicators. So we went to the primary health centers, because these are extremely poor people, tribal communities. They don't have access to any modern healthcare system. So they go to the government primary health centers. So we picked up the data for 5 years. And what we found was absolutely spectacular. In 5 years, since they have been bio-villages, the incidence of major diseases, cancer, anemia, diarrhea, and lots of other diseases, dropped by 90%. It's incredible.
90.
Published. Then we engaged a third party researcher to actually go and pick that up and crunch those numbers. So different, the maximum is 90, the minimum is 73%. But that's extraordinary. No intervention whatsoever. It's just the food they have been consuming, and the fact that the farmers are not exposed to these pesticides themselves. When you are spraying, you get a healthy dose of all those chemicals entering your body, yeah, in your bloodstream, you know. So.
And so, Satya, just following up on that,
okay,
we had the conversation last night with our friend from Nigeria about, hey, this model's working in Andhra Pradesh, India, but it has to be customized as we bring this to other parts of the world. So as we look to Mexico or Nigeria as two examples, what are some of the areas of customization do you see that could help this movement or this concept of community natural farming scale to other countries like Mexico or Nigeria? What are some of those key factors?
I think about 70% is the same. But then in every country, you have to do some scientific testing of the animals where you're using cow dung or the cow urine in terms of, so it's not like some grandfather's agriculture, you know, oh, you take cow dung and cow urine and do it. No, it works because it has microbes. And so you, when you have other things added, whether it is buttermilk, whether it is lentil flour, or whether it is aloe vera, there's all kinds of stuff they add, which is all documented and tested and practiced, the microbial count increases exponentially. So this is basically helping the soil bring back the microbes. So in a funny cartoon kind of way, getting the nematodes to rescue us, whom we can't even see. Yeah. So that's what is happening. So about 70% is the same. 30% is community. 30% is individual behavior. And how do you see that? What practices? And also to look at what practices are already in place in a certain community or a country level. And how can you leverage those practices? So that there is no one size fits all. But in terms of the principles, one size fits all. But then also, it differentiates from crop to crop, from one agroclimatic zone to another agroclimatic zone in the kind of concoctions you need, but it's all natural and all available for free mostly. And it's just about the knowledge transition and that it works. The one thing that is worth keeping in mind, and it's very important in the context of India, currently, the Indian government spends $30 billion. These are their published numbers, 2022 numbers. $30 billion in fertilizer subsidies. India has 120 million farmers. For $200 per farmer to switch, it costs $24 billion. So you will actually save 20% within 1 year of subsidies. So it's not like some country needs to come and give money to another country to make the switch. You can make the switch yourself, actually. That's how sound an economic model this is. You don't need to do the switch in 1 year. You can't. But you do it over 10 to 15 years. Then at the end of it, so if you add up all these subsidies, India subsidies, $30 billion fertilizer subsidies, $18 billion farm electricity subsidies. Then there's farm loan waiver. Then there is interest subvention schemes. Then there is product development schemes. So it's a total $70 billion that India spends every year on these subsidies. With a $24 billion investment over the next 10 years, it can all get to zero, literally.
Thank you, Satya. So with a little creativity, it seems like we could really scale this in a big way. It requires public and private. And I think we got to hold the private sector not just accountable, but get them at the table. And honestly, I tried to reach out to some of my private sector CPG, consumer product, good brand offtakers to join the panel. And right now, if I could break this down in terms of the market challenges, there's export and there's domestic. And when you talk to the UN agencies, talk to the governments, they're all about food security locally. So taking the fresh produce harvests, you know, the grains, the roots, the tree crops, and things that can go to local markets and making sure there's a strong domestic market. But the other side of this, which is really driving all the movement of capital, is around the global offtake partners. So one question I have, maybe Satya and maybe Sol, you could speak to domestic markets. What are some of your ideas or some strategies so that we can more actively engage the leading brands and retailers on both the global level as well as the domestic level to be more engaged in these conversations, to go beyond the rhetoric and the platitudes and everything around regenerative and sustainable into actually moving towards contracting outputs from these farming communities?
So the first thing is a strategic one. So the strategic one is this, that the global GDP is about 30% in the public sector and 70% in the private sector. For far too long, we have been talking about who pays whom, loss and damage, and you know, you caused this much emission, so you should pay. That's a good conversation. I'm not saying that's a great conversation, and that must be had. But to believe that 30% of the money or the global GDP on which the governments have so much demand from their citizens on services, utilities, and everything else, to believe that there will be enough savings to solve 100% of the problem globally is naive. And the reason that this whole conversation about $100 billion a year by 2020 hasn't happened is because there is no money. So we can keep talking about it. Doesn't help. We need to focus on the 70%. That's where the money is. That's where the damage is. It's perhaps 70% of the GDP, but the damage is 100% because that's where governments don't do damage to the environment knowingly. It is companies and the practices and the consumers who want the cheapest. So we can demonize companies very easy, but we have played an equally bad part in it because we go to the supermarket, we look for the cheapest producers. So that has to change. So at a strategic level, to understand that the corporate is a 70% part in both the resources and the solution, perhaps even bigger in the solution. And the second one is, of course, getting them to the table, not as a disturbed neighbor, I need to get this disturbed neighbor into my ambit so that they don't shout too much but actually take them as an enabling partner and start a real conversation about, and in that, the public institutions interact with corporates very little because we somehow have created this firewall. If you are seen too much with a corporate, you are corrupt. That is not true. Politeness and firmness can go hand in hand. I have been dealing with corporates all my life as a public servant, both nationally and internationally. Nobody has ever offered me a cup of coffee that was undeserved. Because you offer me a cup of coffee, I make sure the next two cups I pay for it. But I built a relationship over that cup of coffee. So I don't demonize you, you're giving me a cup of coffee. No, you don't like that? Buy the next cup of coffee. Then you're at an equal level. But let not that little cup of coffee prevent you from building a policy that could be helpful for tons of coffee that goes to the market. So, we have to, this artificial divide in our heads between what is public and what is private is really self-defeating. Because what is private is public, what we accept it or not, because the negative externalities are now drowning the planet. So we really need to see the corporate world as an ally in this great fight. Thank you.
Thank you, Satyen. So there are a lot of public sector people even in the audience here and at this event, of course. So they have the power and the tools to get corporates to say, come sit down, let's have a conversation.
They certainly do.
Okay. So that's one solution. We got to get them at the table, not demonize, but invite them inclusive to be part of a better future, which will help them secure their profitability.
Absolutely.
And so, look, we have the tools here. And when public sector calls, they probably get a little nervous. Why are you calling me? Because normally they get called when they're in trouble. But if they're being called because they could be part of a solution, that could be a great way to start bridging this chasm between public-private sector in order to drive these critical solutions.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Great. Well, to finish off here at this panel, I'd love to get some final words from Sol and from Sati and maybe myself around what is something that you're inspired by and feeling really life positive and optimistic around regenerative agriculture, food systems.
Well, for me right now is that since we are getting not into the just the climate change, but in the climate crisis, I think that instead of feeling bad about it, I think that that should inspire us, because when people realize that our life and the life of our kids depends on doing something, I think that we are in the tipping point where more people will be getting into the business of doing something for the planet. So that's very inspiring for me. Besides having the great honor to work in the government, which I like to be a public servant, I have to say that, and having the opportunity to put together people to facilitate how we reach better solutions. So that's the other inspiration that I have. And what I wanted to add to the conversation is another main issue that we have in Mexico is not just with the public, the private sector, which is, I agree, very, very important, and we have to add it to the formula. It's also how can we work better at different levels in the government. So that's a challenge for us. We have been working at the federal government, and we have arrangements with the state governments, so we are getting down to the field. Then we have the municipal levels, and I have a very nice example in Michoacán where you were mentioning that there's this idea of rescuing lakes. We have the second biggest lake in Michoacán, which is Lago Cuitzeo, and it's drying. And having a lake that is drying, it's worrisome for everybody. So everybody is adding to the conversation. Everybody is working in these intersectional tables, because it's not just the problem of the fishermen in the lake. It's also the problem of the tourist people who cannot get the lake to be visited. It's a problem for the people around the lake when you get this Tolvaneras, which I don't know how to say it in English. It is like dust flying around, and they cannot reach sandstones because of the dryness of the lake. So you know that it's a problem that affects all. So you know that everybody has to participate and be there. So I think that this crisis is opening our eyes and letting us know that we have to work together or else.
Muchas gracias, Sol. And I'll share mine so that we can end with Satya's final thoughts. And,
yeah,
you know, I'm optimistic and feeling really charged up, because a year ago in Glasgow, food and agriculture was barely on the sideline. And now, 1 year later, it is the center. And I believe this conversation will continue to be the center. And I want to also go back to the public sector and say, institutional purchasing makes up a large percentage of food systems in each country. So how can we also look at ourselves, public, private sector, and say, what opportunities do we have with purchasing power to genuinely commit contracts to purchasing to support these programs that we heard today and ones like it around the world, so that there is that confidence and there is that real contracted financing for the transition to these agroforestry and regenerative systems. So with that, I'll leave you with the final word, Satya.
Well, what inspires me is that what we are seeing in this particular program I talk a lot about is that poor people for the first time in their lives can actually eat clean food. Because with this whole organic revolution that we've been talking about, organic started becoming mainstream about 50 years ago. It went into NPK, nitrates, phosphates, and potassium, and then came back to organic. But organic, if you take the entire organic landscape on the planet, it hasn't even breached 1% of the cropped area. Why? Because it's expensive. It requires a lot of land. And the composting and all kinds of transportation footprint, because you're trying to do, it's still a fertilizer-based farming. You're just trying to use biomass fertilizer instead of synthetic chemical fertilizer. So if you're trying to find the nitrogen in Mars, it is really a huge mass that you have to transport in terms of compost. In regenerative agriculture, it's circular, it's a bioinoculation system. Everything is local, nothing is transported anywhere. It happens right there at the field level. So, and the farmers now, which number more than a million, they can actually eat clean food because they're producing it themselves. It doesn't need you to be rich or very smart to do an organic farm. Everybody is doing it now. So that's huge, because for the first time, their children will live to their fullest potential, not ending up in hospitals with endocrine disruptors and what have you. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that something we don't talk about much is the food feed food nexus. Now there is this whole idea of one health that everybody talks about, that animal health is intrinsically connected to human health, which we saw with COVID, and there are more many, many more pandemics waiting in the wings. So what we don't eat in terms of chemically produced food is that we wash our fruits and vegetables. It's all good for us, but a major part of the plant is actually left behind to be eaten by animals. That's not cleaned in the way we clean our food. So they eat that, all those chemicals concentrate in their body, and then we eat them, those of us that are non-vegetarian. So then you still end up eating all those chemicals. Whether you washed your vegetables or not doesn't matter. Your meat can't be washed. So the food feed food nexus to be kept in mind. And in these landscapes, that has switched completely. Whether you're getting fish from a pond, it's not a pond full of potassium and nitrates. When you're eating a lamb meat or goat meat or buffalo meat, which is very common in India, you don't, because they are eating the clean plants themselves. So that will also have a significant impact for the non-vegetarians, because they are again not eating any animal protein that is laced with chemicals. So I think at multiple levels, our relationship with food, what it does for us, not in just in terms of nutrients and giving us the energy, but in terms of defining who and what we will be in our lives in many more ways than we understand, I think is crucial. So that's what inspires me when we talk about regenerative agriculture. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Satya. Maybe a round of applause here for Sol, Satya, Stephanie, and thank you all for being here with us. Appreciate it.